Abdoulaye Dukule. Dr. Du, welcome to Focus on Liberia.
Thank you, Dennis. How are you doing?
I'm doing excellent. And we want to welcome our viewers across the globe. This is Focus on Liberia. We're going to be focusing on part three of the Liberian Civil War, or the uncivil civil war. Dr. Dukule is here with us tonight to discuss his experience with the war and analysis as to why we went to war and how can we avoid a recurrence. If we have time, using his vast experience in Liberian politics, he will also discuss some current events. So Dr. Du, we are so glad to have you.
Thank you very much. And I would like to say happy Father's Day to all the fathers and also to the mothers who played the role of fathers when there was no father. And definitely, you know, everybody is involved in this holiday, I think. So I'm here. Thank you. And I'm pleased to be with you.
Thank you. And we want to wish all fathers out there happy, happy Father's Day. This is, we are glad that we are having Focus on Liberia discussion on Father's Day. And fortunately for us, we have two fathers here. That's me and Dr. Du. Dr. Du, let's share some of your father's experience. I don't know what the girls did for you today.
The girls, what they did for me, they made me breakfast and they made me lunch. They invited all their friends and then the other kids came up. We are actually, everybody's in the living room. As you know, technology, everybody's now on their phone. There's 7, 8 people here. Everybody's on their own phone and taking pictures. So I had a very beautiful, great day. And I cannot imagine not having these children in my life.
Great, great, great. All right. Again, tonight is Focus on Liberia, the Liberian Civil War. This is part three. In part one, we had the accounts of some journalists.
Yeah.
Part two, we had the accounts of some survivors of the Liberian Civil War. Part three, we're going to have someone who participated in the peace conference, who was friends with people in power and also served on a very high level. And our guest is Dr. Abdoulaye Dukule. He's the former advisor to Dr. Amos C. Sawyer during his time when he was president of the interim government. He's also served as advisor to President Ellen Johnson Sirleaf. Before that, he was professor at the University of Liberia. He served as chairman of the Department of French under then President Merritt Antonin Brown Sherman. Dr. Dukule is also a journalist. He worked as a producer of Alpha Blondie. He was working with Alpha Blondie of the Ivory Coast when he produced the music Peace in Liberia. In the 1990s, Dr. Duke also worked on the campaign, the last campaign of Félix Houphouët-Boigny of Ivory Coast. In 2012, when he served under President Sirleaf, he worked 6 months in the Ivory Coast working on some peace issues or some negotiation when there were some rumors or some reports of shooting along the border. So for 6 months, he works in the Ivory Coast in the Liberian Embassy, working directly with President Alassane Ouattara. Dr. Dukule, welcome again. And you also work with the Perspective newspaper.
Yes, I'm a member of the Perspective team. I joined the team back in 1991. I was working as an editor, and then, you know, I went home. But now I'm back on it. So yeah, we worked, you know, we're very close. It's a very close team working together for the last 20, 25 years. And I might add something for the Perspective, is that every politician has approached us to say, how can we help you? We always say, no, this is our project. We pay with our 2 cents and we're not going to take no money from no politician ever. It never happened.
All right. We want to welcome all our viewers across the globe. Again, this is Dennis Ja. We are broadcasting from Atlanta, Georgia. My co-host, Danielle Knuckles-Guishard, is out spending Father's Day with Uncle tonight. And next week, she's going to be with Daddy to enjoy Father's Day. My guest relations manager, Stephanie Cetro, is also spending Father's Day with Hubby. And all those having Father's Day, again, once again, we say welcome and happy, happy Father's Day. Dr. Duke, we're going to talk about the Liberian Civil War. So we started December 24th, 1989. Before December 24th, 1989, tell us briefly about some of your activities. Where were you? What were you involved in prior to the start of the Civil War?
I had just given up my tenure track position in New York at St. Lawrence University and moved back home. And it's funny how things happen. I was teaching, I went back to teach at LU, trying to make a movie. I had a screenplay that I wrote with Baltimore on his book, The Money Doubler. In the process, I was teaching a class of 202, you know, kind of advanced level. And one of the students that many people know, Dexter Tyer, who became member of the Council of State later on, came to me one day after class. He said, "No, Doc, if I were you, I'll leave the country." I said, "What are you talking about?" He said, "Well, I was someplace last night and I heard your name. And I think if I were you, you would leave." Because at the time the government knew that there was an invasion coming. And he added, he said, you know, the question they asked, he said, "Why is he coming back? All his friends and colleagues have left." Because everybody at the university that I worked with, who was close to me, had been kicked out of the country somehow. So Dexter Tyer saw my name on the list and said, you know, if I were you, I think I would leave pretty soon. And the same day, I jumped in a car, Vanja Richards from Clay Ashland, whom I knew back from Clay Ashland anyway, gave me a ride. I stopped at the Ethiopian Airlines, bought a ticket, got on a flight and went to Abidjan. And then start working with Alpha and then got involved in the Fort Bunyan's campaign. And then after that, while I was doing that, the peace negotiations moved to Ivory Coast. And I got in touch with Amos Sawyer. Dr. Sawyer, at the time, he was president of the interim government. He told me, he said, "You know what? We're coming here. Fort Bunyan's leading the process. None of us know anything about this country or this, you know, we don't speak French. You know these people, you work with the old man, so please, can you help us?" I said, "You know, I just started a business and, you know, it's just picking up," because I was also working with the American Chamber of Commerce in Abidjan. And with Alpha Blondie, as you know, we traveled together and all of that. And he said, "No, it's just gonna take 2-3 weeks. So I packed my bags, went to Monrovia, and I'm still on the road. So that's how I got involved in the peace process. And mostly I was involved with dealing with Ivory Coast. You know, there was an issue that Ivory Coast was the entry point for the NPFL, and also with Guinea and then Burkina Faso. So all the major Francophone countries that were involved in the war were kind of under my radar. So I traveled a lot in the Ivory Coast, and I have family background in Ivory Coast, so that helped me a lot, because my brother was also anchor at the national TV for news. So I was able to get press media for the interim government at the time.
So what exactly were you doing talking to those people?
What I was doing was, first, I remember the first time we went to Yamoussoukro, when I went to Monrovia, we were preparing for the second Yamoussoukro conference. And Dr. Sawyer asked me what I think we should do. I said, "You know what, the first thing we should do is information. Ivorians don't have any clue of what is going on. Two, as having been in Ivory Coast, they've been suppressing information on Liberian war. They've been pushing down information on the TV, not to show what was happening next door. And I don't think," I say, "we need to also let Ufuk Banyu know what exactly is going on, because some of the people may be deceiving him." You know, he was 93, 94 at the time. He hardly knew the difference between day and light. So the first thing we did, Lamini Warite was Minister of Information. We went to Abidjan. Booked into the hotel that supposedly was belonging to Ufuk Banyu. It was the biggest hotel in town. And then call a press conference. And we call a press conference. The Minister of Information of Liberia was going to speak to the press. And then I called my friends in the media, because I had worked in the campaign, so I knew all the media people. It was packed, standing room only. And Lamini Warite, as you know, is not a guy who mixes his words. He went ahead and explained, the role of Ivory Coast, what Ivory Coast can do, and how Taylor was undermining the peace process by using Ivory Coast. And that was the turning point in our relationship with Ivory Coast. Burkina Faso was just talking to Blaise Compaoré. I went to Blaise many times, talked to him about the issues. His point was always, he actually talked to me in Mandingo, saying, you know what, Taylor and I are like blood brothers. So whatever he does in Liberia, you guys need to resolve that. But my friendship with him will never, ever change. I said, oh. I said, there are a lot of problems going on. And, you know, Amara Essi, who was Minister of Information, Minister of Foreign Affairs in Ivory Coast, asked me to talk to you and that maybe we could get Taylor to, because this was right after we had ECOMOG and everything. He said, there's whatever you want to do as Liberians, I have no problem with it. But what I can tell you is that Taylor and I have a blood link and I'm not going to change my mind about him. But later on, he did. By 2001, 2003, he changed his mind. So that's what I was doing. And then Guinea also the same thing. Whenever I went to Guinea, the chief of protocol was named, his name was Dukule. You know, the name Dukule come from Dukule. So it was easy to talk to him. And it was easy to get him to get on the president, to get the president, President Conde on the phone. And we did a lot of things that they were diplomatic, but people thought it was lack of money, but I thought it was very, because we could ask Ufo Boigny, there's a meeting in Yamoussoukro, but we don't have a plane. I'll call Amara AC. He said, okay, we'll send an airplane to you. That was part of our media. It was all part of the media and then our communication process. Whenever we were going to Addis, I remember we were going to Addis and I called Conde. I say, you know, we don't have a plane. We heard you're going to Addis with your 707. He said, yeah, no problem. You want to ride with us? Yeah, we send a plane to pick you up. You pick me up and then we go to Addis. So we did a lot of those things, just little things, but to, you know, pushing our views. Because when you travel with somebody on a plane for a few minutes, you can say, hey, this is what we're doing. So my work was to explain to the Francophone people, Burkina Faso, that was very close to Charles Taylor on one hand, to Ivory Coast that was used as an entry point for Charles Taylor, and to Guinea, who's our strongest partner in the peace process, in the fight against the NPFL invasion.
Right, but like for Ivory Coast, they knew about the war and they were strongly behind Taylor and also Burkina Faso. Were you talking to them to kind of withdraw support for Taylor or, you know, with supporting Taylor with one hand and talking peace with the other hand? What was it like?
We were doing both. It was multi-layer diplomacy. Like for example, at official level, we talked to the Ivorians about the peace process because Ufo Boigny was chair of the Committee of Nine. So we had to talk to him at that level and say, okay, Mr. Chairman, these are the issues. Either NPFL breaking this pact or not, this is what we need to do. But at a different level, I used to work closely with Amara AC, who was Minister of Foreign Affairs, and also some of the security people. And there was other people who also worked with me. Peter Johnson, the former Peter, you know, the late Peter Johnson was part of that negotiation process. Jimmy Quay, Dr. Jimmy Quay, who lives in France now, was also very much part. So we had different levels of talking to people. Ivory Coast, it was about saying, close your border. And Burkina Faso, it was, can you stop this training of rebels in your country? And then let us move forward with the peace process. Because without those two countries' collaboration, there was no way we could have a breakthrough. And of course, it was seen in a sub-region. You remember now, there are 15 African, West African countries that forms ECOWAS. ECOWAS was in charge of the peace process, and they had given the process to Ufo Boigny. Nigeria didn't want to play a front role because they had the military force, the biggest military force on the ground. Ghana was sort of ambivalent. Ghana has very close relationship with Libya, and Libya was supporting Charles Taylor, but they were also part of the peace process. In fact, their soldiers were guarding the fourth floor where MOCS used to live. So you see how, you know, the difficulty we're dealing with. But we had to deal with Ghana, and people went to Ghana a lot. I remember Community Wise, you know, he had come from Ghana to to join the peace process, and therefore he used to go to Ghana. And Mohamed Chambers, who is now the UN man at for West Africa, was our man. So we talked to everybody at every level. It was not one level, and the security people. Jimmy Quay used to talk to the security people. We never stay in the same hotels. We never talked to the same people, but we always managed to get all the information we needed and then to make our policy. And our policy was very simple. It was based on what the peace process began with. One, disarmament of all the warring factions. Two, elections, and that was it. So we don't, and MSL was not ready to compromise on that. So those are the things that we were trying to sell to everybody, that we didn't have a conflict with Charles Taylor as interim government. Our problem was we didn't want to allow anybody to walk into the mansion with a gun. And that was the same thing. And that actually came from the interfaith mediation. It was not made up by the interim government. This was something that was agreed upon by the interfaith mediation committee with Sheikh Kafumba Konte, Michael Francis, and other people that put that document together. And that document became our guiding line. And so we never changed from that.
Okay. So did you actually experience the war going through checkpoints and what have you? I learned you left before the war actually started in Monrovia.
Well, I left, but I came back. I left before the war, and then I returned in 91 when we thought we had a peace process going on. I experienced checkpoints. Yes, there were checkpoints all over Monrovia. And I did go to Wanga on some missions at night, driving through checkpoints. And then also I was there during Octopus. So I experienced the war. In fact, I remember I was in Cotonou with Bacchus, the late Gabriel Bacchus Mati, for a peace meeting, and then when Octopus started. And when we were going back, El Codiva was going, we were like four people, myself, General Yex, who was at IDB Bank at the time, not IDB, but the other bank, and Bacchus Mati and his wife. And they, as I said, but everybody running away, why are you going? He said, why are you going? I said, well, I was on a mission, so I'm going back home to report to the president. So that, yeah. And then I went back and then fell right in the middle of the war. The city was being bombed. And I remember going back to my room at the Duco. There were probably 15 people sleeping in my one bedroom with my wife.
So what would be... Now you were talking, what were some of your other activities, roles and responsibility as part of the interim government?
I'll give you an example. I remember going one time for a paradigm, the late Baron Ta asked me, say, what's your role in the government? I see you on every delegation, you got different name. I mean, not different name, but you got different functions, because sometimes I was translator, sometimes I was advisor, sometimes I was advisor on Francophone affairs, and what, depending on what the president wanted me to do. But definitely, but I was not minister, I was not assistant minister or anything. I was working directly with him and taking my assignment from him. And I was part of every delegation. I think I went to 35 to 36 peace meetings between 1991 and 2003.
So, and we'll get deep into those peace meetings, but let's look at the interim government.
Yeah.
How did the interim government help either to prolong the war or to, because we're hearing activities that Dr. Sawyer was somehow connected to Charles Taylor, that they were part of ACDL that contributed to the NPFL, even though at some point he denied. You were at that level. What do you know about the connection between the interim government and Charles Taylor? And if there was some underhand game being played by between the two, Taylor and Sawyer?
I don't think there was any underhand play between Amos Sawyer and Taylor. What I remember the most is that Amos said, whatever we do, we are not going to leave this country to a gunman. And there were a lot of people negotiating the Carter Center, Ambassador Jim Mason, who went back and forth, and then ECOMOG were negotiating between us. But the whole point was we are not going to leave the country to a warlord, meaning not Taylor as a warlord, not Taylor as a person, but Taylor as a warlord could not access the mansion. And Ekomo was ready to stand by us. But at the same time, we also knew that we needed to negotiate with him. So we talked to him. There were people in the interim government who had families in Banga. In fact, people used to come from Banga to go dance at a nightclub called Bacardi. Every night, we used to meet and have drinks. So we knew what was going on. We were negotiating. But the whole point was, there was one cardinal point that nobody wanted to put aside. That was, everybody had to disarm before the war, I mean, before we could have elections. And Taylor saying, well, I have 90% of the country. You only got 10% or 5% of the country. So I'm the legitimate person to run these things. And we say, we agree with ECOWAS. ECOWAS saying, no, we can't allow this to happen. You have to go through elections, and you cannot go through elections without disarmament. Well, of course, things took a different turn, but definitely that was a project. And I don't think, and Amos always said, I remember we went to Egypt, Cairo, and a Jeune Afrique journalist asked Amos, what would you consider as success? Amos Sawyer said, my greatest success would be to work myself out of job, to be able to walk away from this presidency and say, okay, now we have disarmament, we have people who are ready to work with the whole country, not as gunmen, but as citizens, peaceful citizens. So no, there was no, interim government did not delay. Taylor did not want to disarm, and he didn't.
Yeah. Because one of the things we heard was ECOMO was about to kind of move Taylor, push him all the way, and Dr. Sawyer stopped him. And one of those reasons that so that he could remain interim president, or because he has some sympathy with Charles Taylor. So no, he did not want ECOMO to just push, I think it was Dungoyaro, to push him all the way at once.
Dungoyaro was stopped by ECOWAS. You remember that ECOMO was now under the interim government. The interim government could not stop or order ECOMO to do anything, except when they were attacked. The incident you're talking about, Dungoyaro was on his way to push Taylor all the way back to somewhere near Ganta. He came and said, we have to go back to the negotiation table. We knew where that was coming from, because every time there was an advance against Taylor, Ghana somehow, under Jerry Rawlings, who was very close to Libya, and Libya was a sponsor for Charles Taylor, who come and say, you know what, if you guys are going to do this, if you want to resolve this the military way, I'm going to step up. That happens many times, and that was always a threat. The Ghana was the stopping force. The interim government never had the capacity to order ECOMOC to do anything. So people believe that. I heard that story many times. They said, why didn't you eliminate Charles Taylor? Why did you stop with Dungoyaro? I said, no, we had no command over these people. ECOMOC would start something, and then they would stop when they want to. So that was the problem. No, it was not Emoso. Emoso never stopped anybody from. What he said, though, when people came in and asked him, they wanted to, a group came in and said, we want to take Taylor out. They came with paperwork, and they said, we know where he sleeps, we know where he eats, where he goes out to at night. They have surveyed him for like 2 weeks, but we also had our own information. That was the only time Emoso said no. You say, our problem is not just Taylor. It is a system that we don't have, a structure that we don't have. If you kill Taylor now, you have 10 more small Taylors, because there were 5-6 people in the group, in the NPFL, who were ready to take over NPFL at any time. And at the time, we also had a growing menace from ULIMO that was coming from Guinea and Sierra Leone. And that the only time I remember that Amos saying, no, don't touch Charles Taylor, because that would not solve the problem.
Looking back now, do you think that was a mistake?
I don't know if it was a mistake. Because we had ULIMO at the time coming from, ULIMO had already taken Bomi. We had people around Taylor who were working with us. I don't want to call names, but some of them are still alive. They're very big people, Dookie died, so we can, you know. And some of them were working with interim government. And they also were ready to take over ECMO. And the idea was, they were ready to take over NPFL. Either you take over NPFL or you want to join us somehow, but definitely we are not going to be part of sponsoring assassination. And we also try to work as a government. You know, democratic government don't assassinate people. It was a very small government. We had no money. We're all packed up in that little ducor with the rats and the cockroaches and all of that. But we tried to work as a democratic government. So we said, no, we're not going to be part of an assassination plot.
And this interim government was established when the current president, that time, President Doe, was still in power.
Yeah. Well, the interim government was established because Doe had lost control of the governance process. What happened when Banjul started, when the meeting started in Banjul. By the time the meeting started in Banjul, we had Prince Johnson almost close to Cardwell. We had Charles Taylor Troop in Buchanan and Kakata, if you wish. Where was Doe's power? Doe had to retrench himself into the mansion, and there was a call for interim government to be formed because he could not lead, and he had actually accepted to leave. Doe had accepted to leave. The U.S. provided something to take him out, but he said he wanted to take 500-600 people with him. They said, no, we can't take 500-600 people, but we can take you and your family, immediate family. But when the government was formed in Banjul, Doe was still in a mansion, but he had no way to go anywhere. Prince Johnson was in Cardwell base. Taylor was surrounding him. And then for the idea of an interim government came about. And Taylor was part of the first interim government, actually. I mean, he sent delegates to Banjul, but he said he would not be part of it unless he becomes the chairman. Actually, the one stepping block throughout the whole process, Taylor saying, unless I'm in power, unless I run this country, I'm not going to negotiate any peace process. So that was a problem.
Yeah, the reason I ask that is if you had the power to kill Taylor, but you couldn't. Now you also had the power of we have a legitimate government. Mm-hmm. We can have the vice president, since Doe has lost control, we can have the vice president take over. But you did form an interim government, which was in a way an overthrow, a political overthrow of the current government. But yet you are the one who is sparing the life of Taylor. President Doe is dead, he was killed. So why couldn't you have Taylor killed as well? So it still means the same thing, because you have politically overthrown Doe.
You know, there's war and there's war. Doe was killed. He was, arrested by Prince Johnson and his group and taken, we all know that story. But I don't think Amos Sawyer or any of us who were working with him were ready to say, let's go assassinate somebody we are fighting against, because we knew the dynamics that were on the ground. It was not easy to say, killing Taylor was not the solution. Absolutely not at the time. And anybody who tells that, people will say, if you had killed him in 2003, probably April 6th would not have happened, or probably 2009, 2001 would not have happened. But those are speculations. You know, we knew how many small groups were being formed in the country. I remember now, when we are concluding the Yamoussoukro Accord, Yulimo pop up. We went back to negotiation with Yulimo. As we went to Cotonou to sign the peace accord with President Soglo, and De Gaulle was there, Vice President De Gaulle was there. What happened the next time, with the next morning we wake up after signing the accord, there's another peace council from the Southeast had emerged. So nobody knew how people were getting arms, a lot of people make a lot of money from the war. Yeah. And we saw that dynamic, that every time you thought something was happening, that you were reaching someplace, some group would come up. And these were groups that represented very big constituencies who had problems. You're talking about Nimba, that had been victimized by Doe, that led somehow to the war, however you see it. You had the Maniga people. At some point when the war was approaching Monrovia, people used to say, oh, they're only killing Maniga people. You ask anybody who lived in Monrovia at the time, they'll tell you. Up to May, April, people thought the war was just about Maningos and Crown people.
Yeah.
But then Maningo people got killed. I mean, you just have to look like a Maningo man in a queue, and they take you out and shoot you. So you have Prince Johnson. That's why today when we talk about war crime and all of that, we have to take these things into consideration. Doe had killed so many Nimbeans, but the Nimbeans, when they came back for the war with Taylor, they killed so many innocent people, and mostly Mandingos, because they had an issue with Mandingos in Nimba. And then the Crown people. So what happened? You had one hand, you have Alhaji Krumah emerging, saying, I'm going to be the salvation for the Mandingo people. And then you had George Boley saying, I'm going to help my Grandjere people, my Crown people who have also been victimized. So you had Taylor fighting for the Republic, Prince Johnson fighting for Nimba, Alhaji Krumah fighting for the Maniga people, George Boley fighting for the Crown people. So yeah. You had a tripartite war, and it was not like shooting somebody overnight that would solve that problem. Hmm. And killing Taylor, I would never sit and discuss somebody is being killed. I mean, I'm anti-death penalty anyway.
All right. So there were so many of these peace conferences, mm-hmm. and finally we have peace. But what were some of the impediments to having peace at that time, that we have to go to so many peace conferences, so many people have to die? I have to go through a lot of suffering. I mean, 1990, my family and I, we walked all the way to Cotton Tree. 92, we walked all the way to Lac in Grand Basel. 96, we got in the car, went to through local tour to go to, and these were for weeks. Why the peace process took so long?
Because there were too many issues on the ground to resolve. One of the issues was, I just like I told you, the first meetings we had was with Charles Taylor, Yamoussoukro Accord. We had three meetings in Yamoussoukro. The fourth one, we agreed. Taylor said, well, he was getting information that there was another group coming in called Yulimo. And it was true. Alhaji Krumah and other people were organizing in Sierra Leone to set up a room group. So we went to Geneva at Ufuibonye's house. And Taylor said, oh yeah, I need 1,000 Senegalese troops to help me with the disarmament. Ufuibonye asked him, why do you need 1,000 Senegalese? He said, because I don't trust Nigerians. They're sending troops in Sierra Leone and Guinea to send to attack me. Ufuibonye told me, he said, you know what? Your best security safety network is your neighborhood, your neighbor. If your neighbors don't protect you, you're not going to be protected. But to say that we went from as soon as we concluded the Yamoussoukro process and Taylor had agreed to disarm somehow, we come back, Yulimo is under the attack. But Yulimo didn't enter Bomi till Taylor tried to attack Monrovia, to take over Monrovia. Because Taylor was adamant that no matter what happened, he was not going to disarm. Yeah. So we conclude with that, and then Yulimo takes over a bunch of territory from Taylor overnight, and Taylor get pushed back again. A new negotiation process start. We go to between 10 meetings. I remember one meeting we had in at the UN headquarters in Geneva. We met for 27 hours nonstop. If you're tired, you go take a nap and you come back with Bagos Matthew, Mamoru Seli, Tomu Oyu, everybody was there, Galawolo. That's when that term concomitant came about. And then by the time we go to Cotonou, we sign it with Vice President Dogolie, sing the national anthem. By the time we finish the national anthem, the next morning we hear, Liberian Peace Council, LPC of George Boley had attacked. And then we had to start another process of negotiation.
So Taylor was not the main problem. It was coming to attack him.
Yeah, he was being attacked from both sides. He was being attacked by Yulimo on one hand. He was also being attacked by the LPC. His territory was chunking, shrinking. And finally, you know, when he had no more power at all to say, I'm the biggest warlord, also with, but we knew he was also the biggest warlord in Liberia to the end of the process, he accepted to go to negotiation.
And so his intransigence in the other world was justified?
I don't know if it was justified. You could say somebody, you know, I thought if under Yamoussoukro, if he had disarmed, Ekuma would have probably stopped Alhaji Nkrumah from coming in. And I don't think Bole would have had a chance. But Taylor was adamant. He didn't trust anybody. He didn't trust Ekuma. And the peace accord also said that Ekuma was going to be part of keeping this peace after security after the elections. And he didn't trust that process.
All right. If you are just joining us, this is Focus on Liberia. Our guest tonight is Dr. Abdoulaye Dukule, former advisor to interim president Amos Claudius Sawyer, and also former advisor to President Ellen Johnson Sirleaf. Dr. Duke, there is a question from Facebook. This is from Dr. Samuel Govo.
Mm-hmm.
He said, did the printing of the new money
mm-hmm.
by the interim government of Dr. Sawyer contribute to the intransigence of Prince Johnson to cooperate with the interim government and either to the prolongation of the peace process? What contributions PYJ made to the peace process in Liberia? PYJ, that's Prince Y. Johnson.
Yeah, my good friend from Nimba. He made a contribution in the sense that, one, he broke away from Charles Taylor. Two, he managed to kill Doe, which is bad. But when you say, okay, the war is because of this guy and that guy died, you say, okay, maybe they will have peace, but they will have peace. And also, he was a very good partner to interim government. But that partnership was flawed. Prince Johnson had, I heard, this is, you know, from what I heard, had looted the port of Monroe, the free port, when he arrived. And he took money, containers of money, you know, like the 16 billion we're talking about now. He took containers of money and put them on his base. And that money allowed him to not only corrupt Liberians that work around him, but also even Ekuma, because he had a lot of money to pass it on. You remember that Ekuma was the first regional peacekeeping force ever in the world to be put together by, you know, and it was the first one in West Africa. They was not getting paid on time. They were sleepers, they didn't have food, and some of them were open to corruption. And Prince Johnson was a king in Monrovia, but we had a government and we had an understanding. So what happened is government said, okay, you know what, to stop this thing, because we don't know how much money Taylor got on his side in Greater Liberia. We don't know how much Prince Johnson got, but we know he has a chunk of it, money that disappeared from the port. So let's print a new money and give everybody 24 hours to change it, and that will put an end to that. And that's what happened. I may add, this was the best kept secret in Monrovia. Somebody at the U.S. Embassy later on asked me, said, how did you manage to keep secret that you were printing new money and get on the market before anybody knew it? I said, well, Amos has a very dedicated team. So that when that money change came in, you had to go to the bank to either change it. If you didn't have an account, you couldn't just stand up in the street and change the money at a time. Prince Johnson lost a lot of money and his power was taken away from him. And then he started to negotiate with Charles Taylor, and that led to Echo Octopus, when he and Charles Taylor were supposed to meet and overrun the government, except that he was planning to grab Charles Taylor and Taylor was planning to grab him.
Cat and mouse. So Dr. Drew, why do you think we really went to war?
I think we went to war because of mismanagement, bad governance that started back in probably 1985. And I think at some point, Samuel Doe became a dictator. People have put tribal ideas in his mind. He started not to trust anybody else. So that had an impact. If you remember, I don't know how old you were, you're probably pretty young, but when they say, when they told me, oh, all his friends have left for the University of Liberia, what is he doing here? That was also pretty much the whole society. Everybody had left. The middle class, the Liberian middle class was back in the US. That's where people like Amos Sawyer, Baronta started the ACDL. The government of Liberia was not functioning. It had become something ethnicized, totally corrupt. And when the war started, a lot of people welcomed the war. Liberian people don't want to admit it now, but a lot of people welcomed the war. I mean, it took a bad turn, but at the time, he had monopoly of the army, totally. He had monopoly of the House. He had monopoly of the Senate. He had monopoly on the Supreme Court. So he could do anything. So you say, okay, the solution is, what do you do to change this man? You're going to shoot him in the street, or you're going to start a war, or you're going to do a coup d'etat. So the war started, people welcomed it, but you know, they say a war is like a stone you throw. You never know what damage it caused when it lands.
I remember at the start of the war, when they had the peace conference in Sierra Leone, the spokesman of the NPFL at that time, Thomas Jukonti Wayu, announced that the war was to avenge the 13 government officials that were killed during the days after the coup.
Yeah.
So to what extent did that play a role in the war, the 1980 coup?
I think people may have made financial contributions to Charles Taylor based on that sentiment. You know, we always have that divide, Congo country, however you look at, you know, even today people still talk about it. I think Taylor had, you know, Taylor was probably the ultimate communication person, definitely. He knew how to use media. He knew how to use communication. He told everybody he was going to have it. You know, he told the Congo people, I'm going to go revenge you 13 people who were killed. And he told the Nimba people, I'm going to salvage you from this man. And he told the rest of the country, we're going to get rid of dictatorship. So he was very good at propaganda, and that worked for him.
So right now, sometimes you hear the drumbeat of war. How can we avoid another war?
Good governance. Good governance, you know, is the key.
That's it?
Good governance is the only key to stopping a war from coming to you. Why people don't go to war necessarily because they're hungry. People don't necessarily go to war because they, you know, they don't have a car, they don't have anything, but they will go to war if they feel that their rights are being trampled on, if they're being stigmatized, they're being excluded from the process, and they have nowhere to know where to turn to. That's what takes people to war. It's not necessarily poverty. And I can tell you today, people thought, oh yeah, June 7 will be a war. I don't think so. I never thought it was going to be a war. I say, yeah, Liberian people have learned their lessons. Nobody's going to start a war. And we had not reached that point of anger that people would say, oh, let's take guns and up and go fight. I don't think that will happen. I don't think that was ever in the books. And I don't think Liberia is going to go to war, because I think we have learned our lessons. I think people know the price of war, the price of peace, and the price of stability. And we have it today for the next generations. How to fix the country now is different. It's a different problem. And you can see the country is totally... Liberia is not what it is really like. People say, oh, we got this, you know, the dollars are $200. I say, you're lucky. Probably be hitting $200-$300 next year. Because our economy is not working. I don't care if you can put anybody there. If you don't change the structures, if you don't change the way we do things, you don't change the way we run the government, it's not going to work. The way we're doing, going by it now, it's not going to work.
So what is your general thought? And most of the time we hear it, no more war, we don't want war. But I believe you have what's your general take on wars? And I'm going to show you an article that you wrote about war. Let me see if I can put it on the screen. And I know this because that was a response to me.
Yeah.
It was in 2009. You said on the issue of people we now call warlords, we also have to agree that we are here today because some people took up arms to fight a level playing field. No matter how we want to look at it, with our new learned ideologies about human rights, war crimes, etc., we will agree that without 1980, 1989, and 2003 conflagrations and changes, we would not enjoy the peace and democracy we have today. That looked to me that you support some wars.
I'm not supporting wars. I'm just saying that things that happened in the past, sometimes you have to play Monday morning quarterback. Things happen, and you say, okay, this is bad, but what is the end result? Without 1980, we would have been talking about majority rule for the next 10 years, 25 years. It wasn't going to happen. Because the American Liberian rulers, people who ruled, I mean, not all American Liberians, of course, but people who were in power, were so entrenched in their habits and their way of thinking that there was no way to change it. And Talbert was caught between being a progressive person or going back to fall into the diehard, status quo. And he never made a decision. And that decision is probably what killed him. But that indecision, I mean. But saying that, 1980 didn't bring, 1980 brought something. It brought something that we can say, a man named Samuel Doe. Doe meaning, which is John Doe, is president of Liberia. It can also mean that 2003, we had Judy Bryan, interim president in between, and then 2005, we had an election, and 2018, we have a George Weah. I grew up in a system where we never questioned the American Liberian legitimacy as holders of the power. We couldn't do it. You could do it if you're a Moja member, you could do it if you're part of one of those groups. But most people live with it, accept it as a fact. It's like, total alienation. So Doe put an end to that. Was he good? Was he bad? No, but that action put an end to that. But Doe became tribal. He became ethnic. He became totally drawn into, he became a paranoid leader. And the only way you could get rid of Doe was through some kind of movement that he understand, either force, because he was a military man, he only understood force, he didn't understand diplomacy, or you go after him the way you can, and Taylor put an end to that. But did it work well? That's another question. There were bad things happening during the war, yes. And then Manuka people would say, yes, without Alhaji Krumah, we would have been left here alone. Thousands of us been dead, and thousands were being killed every day. So therefore, we owe it to Alhaji Krumah to be our person, our liberator in a way.
But
people say the same thing about George Bully.
Yeah, so let's keep with that. Because if we keep with that line of reasoning, mm-hmm. It means any group can get up today and say, well, there's a current government and we are not satisfied. He's doing X, Y, Z, so we can use violence, and you can make the same argument.
No, when the government doesn't kill people, you don't go after them go after them with a gun. We have a democratic process. If you look at June 7, what he taught everybody is that Liberians have learned their lessons. Unless somebody instigate violence, unless somebody come up and say, oh, you know what? We got to go kill somebody tonight. That's a small group thing. I don't think Liberians are, open to go to war. I mean, yeah, we saw those were our learning curves. We learned in 1980. It was a shock. I remember waking up, I remember the aftermath. I had just come from school. And then I remember 96, and then I remember what happened in 2001, all of those things. But all of those things are milestones. When you talk about revolution, there was no revolution more savage than the American Revolution. There was no revolution more savage than the French Revolution. But we had our own. So let's learn from it and then move forward. You can go back and say, okay, so-so-so did something to me. So-so-so did something to somebody. And we need to talk about it. or you need to, you know, punish that person, or you want revenge, or you want some money out of it, whatever it is, those things can still happen in a court of law. But I'm saying every war that happens has brought us further closer to this democracy. And the point, the challenge now is to keep us from ever falling back into those things that happened that took us where we were, but, you know, 20 years ago.
That leads me into the question of war crime court or some form of accountability for those who bear the greatest responsibility in the Liberian civil war.
Yeah.
And one of them, including your boss, who was the initial financier of the mayhem that took place. Where do you stand on war crime court or any form of accountability for those who really did the worst things to us?
I think, you know, when you've been victimized, you have the right to seek justice. And people who have been victimized by the war have the right to seek justice. And I'm one person who many times said, you know, if somebody killed my dad and I know you're still walking the street, I'll go to court and sue you because I know you did it. And I'll take you to court. I will not wait for war crime tribunal. But the problem is Accra, the Accra Peace Accord. The Accra Peace Accord was negotiated by Charles Taylor's government, the political parties, and the two other warring factions, Alert and the one that came from the Southeast. Anyway.
Model and LPC.
Yeah, Model, Alert, the government, and the political parties negotiated the peace process. The war was going on. You remember the bodies in front of the US embassy? People were bombing Monrovia from left and right. The way forward, the warring factions did not want to hear about war crime tribunal. In fact, that was the reason they voted against Ellen Johnson Sirleaf, because she came in with a stand. And it, by the time she changed her stand on the war crime tribunal, the votes are already gone. So Yulimo voted, Lerd voted for her, Model and NPFL voted against her. And that's how she lost the election. What I think about the war crime tribunal, I think it's justified. I think, you know, whenever you have a war, you have people who go beyond their own boundaries, go beyond the boundaries of, you know, war making and civil war and all of those things. You know, people who traumatize people, whole town, they burn a whole city. You take, you know, I've been in Ivory Coast many times. You have been, you know, they had 10 years of war, but you don't see a trace of it anywhere. You don't see no bullet hole in the whole country. You don't see no wire cut, nobody moving to nobody's house. Well, a few people did. But we had a war that was totally destructive. And that's where we have to learn. What is totally wrong at the base of the country, the foundation? What's the problem with the foundation? Because that foundation is the problem. When you have people destroying the whole country, thinking that they're destroying somebody else's ownership, you know, belonging, burning schools, not thinking, oh, I may go back to this school tomorrow. Or going to LU. I went to LU. We were cleaning LU. The first time we went to clean LU, we part of Dr. Patrick Serio. We found human bodies in the library. We found human parts in the classrooms. Books were burned to keep the war, you know, the faction from getting cold. So I'm not sure if, you know, you could say there's a clear cut way to say this, but I know I will stand for peace and I'll stand for people who committed the biggest crime and you can prove it. I think it should be done. My only problem was the process was politicized from the beginning, the TRC process. That's what we are talking about. That at some point when they released it, it became too politicized. And therefore, as you say, my boss was not encouraged to push it. She did what she could, which was to set up the Independent Human Rights Commission. And that commission was the one that was supposed to take the TRC report and channel it through the legislature, not the president.
Then what happened?
What happened? She set up the committee. I don't know what the committee started, their own palaver hawk thing. I don't know if it was because of lack of financing and also lack of jurisdictional capacity. They didn't go anywhere. Can you say, okay, she set up a committee that was non-functional? There were good people on that committee. My cousin Dukule, who is now the election commission, was part of that committee. They were very good people, Master Washington, Verrier. But at some point, I think the president and the committee fell off. They fell off because the president was being condemned. And because she being condemned as president, if you tell me I'm president, sitting president, then you want to either impeach me or send me to jail, you think I'll say yes, put me in jail?
You mean condemned by the commission she set up or condemned by
the commission? No, by the commission she set up.
Okay.
I think that was a problem. There was a problem between her and the committee.
I think they were just being fair, but she too being bearing some responsibility was, if not paranoid, but she was protecting her own interests. So it's kind of selfish. And as a result, the whole country suffered because you are just protecting yourself.
Well.
Anyway, that was a passing comment. You don't have to respond.
Okay.
All right. There's a question here from Dr. Samuel Ngovo again.
Yeah.
But we're now opening our phone lines. You can call 706-684-0392. Dr. Govo is saying, what were some of the major achievements of the interim government of national unity in the peace process? Why was the interim government necessary for in the first place? And that's the IGNU. Charles Taylor call you the interim government of no use.
Yeah. I think the biggest contribution IGNU was to make sure that we don't hand power to somebody with guns, that nobody walks into the mansion with guns. But we also did things at the legislative level. We talked, we had a working relationship with ECOWAS, and I don't know, I can't say this is what we did that was right, but I would say there was a peace plan that was set up by the Interfaith Mediation Committee, and had an endorsement of ECOWAS, and interim government was set up by the ECOWAS. So therefore, I work into that framework. So, I don't want to say we did this. There's no laundry list of what a government does and doesn't do. If you think about it, you say, okay, we did something, nobody with guns walk into the mansion by the force of guns. Taylor won the elections because people were afraid of him, because he was the bigger warring faction, but he did not shoot his way into the mansion. And that was the whole idea. And since then, it has not happened.
What was some of your failures or the things that you do differently when you get back there as interim government?
What was our failures as interim government? I think the question you always ask is, what could I have done with what I had, and then you can build, sand castles, and then you can go on and say, we could have done this, we could have done that, we could have done this. Yes, somebody would say, you should have killed Taylor. Oh yeah, we should have let this person be minister. But no, I think we tried to run a government. People may say, it was a play government, it was city mayor, but we did have an assembly that controlled the government. People were rejected. I remember our Minister of Finance, the one person in our government who had contact with George Bush at the time, George Herbert Bush, who was president, was Baron Tan. He was rejected by the TLA. When he was rejected, Amos could not impose him. So those things happen, and the code of conduct, we designed the first code of conduct. We made George Boyer ambassador for peace. He was first ambassador of peace under the interim government. We had a place where kids who wanted to leave the war zone could come near the stadium, SKD Stadium. They're being rehabilitated and then sent back into society and to training camp. So a lot of things happen. I can't put my finger to where we fail. That would be other people to say. That's not my job. I can just tell you that we work hard. As I told you, with the rats and cockroaches in the Dukoro, we live there. And we traveled, you know, thousands and thousands of miles to discuss peace. And we never waver on one thing. No warlord will walk into the mansion with a gun.
You work with President Sirleaf.
Yeah.
Immediate past government.
Mm-hmm.
Before I even come to say, and then we have the We Are Presidency. First, let's talk about your roles and responsibility under President Sirleaf. What did you do, and how did that government prepare the way for what we have now?
My work with the interim, with President Sirleaf started way back. I was in Washington. I was running a newspaper, an African journal that I had created. After I left the embassy, I went to teach and started a newspaper, a magazine called the Africa Journal that dealt with Africa in general, with you know, culture, politics, economy. And later on, Ellen saw the paper and contacted me. And, you know, she actually became a member of my board of my editorial board on the paper. And later on, I sold the paper to the Corporate Council on Africa in Washington, D.C. They still run it online. With Ellen, I worked with her from there. I interviewed her whenever she was in Washington. We'll talk. We had a group of people who met. This was not ACDL. A very small group of people who met and discussed Liberian issues. She also had a very good partisanship around this area. The UP was very powerful, so we met with them sometimes. And 2005, you know, I helped with the campaign, but I didn't join the government because I said my kids were young and I wasn't planning to leave them behind and go take any job in Liberia. And I stayed till 2012. My kids had finished high school and they were all in college. So I went to Monrovia. And she said, my first job for you is to go to Abidjan because we have a problem at the border. And actually, before I went to Monrovia, we were in Dakar at the AU, at the ECOWAS conference on Mali and Guinea-Bissau. And I was coming from a bookstore and President Ouattara was coming from a meeting. I was standing looking at a Jeune Afrique copy that I had bought. And he just came and straight to me, he said, my brother, I need your help. I couldn't remember that. I didn't think he remembered me from way back. He said, I need your help. I said, Mr. President, what? He said, you know the issues at the border? I said, yes. He said, you need to bring it to the attention of your president. I need your help. So I told the president, she said, what do you think? And that we talked about it back and forth with the Security Council. And finally she said, okay, you're the only person who can go because you can understand the culture, you know what is going on. So I went to Abidjan, spent about 5-6 months and working with the Ivorian security system and Ouattara and all the people, we were able to resolve the issue. We found out who was doing it, who was commandeering those issues. And then when I went back, she asked me to work on the UN projects. So all my time, actually, I never worked in government. I was doing the post-2015, which was to replace the MDGs with the SDGs. I worked on that. I was her special envoy. And when that was finishing, we started also the AU set up Africa Common Position. And I was also the coordinator of the 10 head of state committee to come up with the African Common Position on the SDGs, which we published. And when that finished, my last assignment was migration, international migration. AU set up another committee and she was chair with UNECA on the committee on migration. So to come up with an Africa position in migration. So I did that. And that went into George Weah government because I didn't leave till September. Although I was, you know, I was still at the mansion doing, going in and out when I wanted to till, you know, after he came to power, I was there for 6-7 months.
So you talk about the trouble along the border.
Yeah.
Is that what resulted into the incarceration of some people from Grand Jide?
Yeah, that was up later on, yeah.
Yeah, so tell me what happened and how they got in jail.
After I left Abidjan, they had issues with their own leadership, and somebody turned up on them. The Ivorians approached them, and somebody went and told them who was doing what. They were not caught in combat. Okay. It was somebody from their own circle who went and, you know, worked with our security people. You know, security people got a way of finding, you know, their own people somehow. So, no, I was in there. When I went, I was the attacks that were coming in. But those mercenaries, they said they were training to go. They had not left. And I don't know how Liberian security got, you know, wind of the activities and caught them.
So what would they be accused of? And are they still in jail?
I think they're still in jail. I remember when I was there not too long ago, somebody was asking about, you know, they should be released. I just want them to, because some of them are Ivorians, some of them are Liberians. So they, you know, and some are both Ivorian and are Liberian.
So now we have a few more minutes before we draw down the curtain. So you are Dr. Duke. You yeah. work with Ellen, and then we have transition to President Weah. We want to get your take on some current issues. First of all, did you work closely with President Sally? Did she support George Weah to become president?
I don't know how much support she gave him. But I know she and Boakai were not at all working together by the time you got to elections. And that kind of disheartened me. If you go on the perspective, as we talk about it, you see an article that I wrote called The Comedy of Errors, where I talk about the fact that Boakai and Ellen had worked together for 12 years, built a house, and just when it was time to put a roof on, they decided to set it on fire. And I said they will be sitting on the podium one day and they're giving power to somebody who will come and dismantle everything they said they did. It's one perspective, but it was written before the election because I knew what was coming. It was written before the election. It was published only after the election was done. But, you know, so I knew that, you know, I don't know how close Ellen was to Joshua, but definitely she and Boakai were now on the same wavelength by the time we got to elections. So therefore, I would say Unity Party lost the election because of its leadership issues.
Right. But not supporting one could also mean the support for the other person.
Yeah. I mean, you know, I understand that. But, you know, I don't want to go into speculation and say, oh, she did or she did not. She and I had a few conversations about it. You know, for example, we talked about, you know, one of the last issues we raised together was that road, the groundbreaking road in Banga, where she was going to break ground for a road to go to Foya, and then George Weah happened to be there, but the vice president didn't show up. That was one of the discussions we had. That was the last time I really talked to her about Boakai or the campaign. But I kept in touch with Boakai, although some of his people also saw him, you know, everybody who was close to President Sirleaf was seen by the Boakai campaign as a spy or an enemy. Although I was in close contact with Boakai, I never went around the campaign. I never talked to the campaign because they pushed everybody else aside. Anybody who was close to Ellen was pushed aside. So I kept my contact with Boakai, talked to him on the phone a few times, but never ever showed my face at his campaign headquarters.
So what is your take on the current government that President Sirleaf maybe willingly or unwillingly put in power?
You know, I don't know if President Sirleaf put him in power. Maybe she failed to get her party reelected. Maybe she and Boakai made a big mistake. But I think Weah won the elections. You know, when he says somebody is stupid, that guy is stupid, he can't do nothing, but the stupid guy won and you lost. So that's the reality. Somebody won the elections and that person is the president. I have no qualm about that. Who did it, who didn't do it? I mean, if you were vice president for 12 years, if I were vice president for 12 years, I would never allow anybody to take power from me. I mean, you would not, if I have to go by every single vote one by one, I'll do it. But you know, those are things that pass. And the government as it is, I've known George Weah since, I told you, we made him peace ambassador in 92, 93. And we're even neighbors at some point. And then I talked to him, and I was one of the first people he called when he won, to talk about, things that he wanted to do, put in his speech. But, I said, no, it's not my place. I did meet him at his house and met him a few times after that. But, definitely, I think it is a government that is working its own way, making mistakes as any government that has been in opposition for 12 years and comes in overnight, not totally prepared to face the policy issues, and not totally, prepared to understand some of the complexity of Liberian politics after the war, that we're still a fragile society. But, it's a government that has 6 years to do its work. So, let's wait and see. If they can find some of the mistakes, my only problem is president should make his assets public, and he should force his ministers, everybody, to declare their assets, because that's the constitution. We work on that document back in 1992. Emo Soya could not pass it. And he kept it. And then when Ellen became president, he became chair of the governance commission. He kept working on it and push it, and then it passed. So George Weah cannot say, I'm supporting the constitution, I want to do this with the constitution, at the same time overlook one of the essential elements of the constitution, because that code of conduct is the most important aspect, new aspect of our governance that has been added since 1985, if you look at the constitution.
You were Vice President Sawyer, you also were Vice President Ellen Johnson Sirleaf. If you were advising President George Manning Weah, what would you tell him?
Oh, depending what the problem is.
Yeah. Do you see any problem that you need to advise him on right now?
Yeah, no, but my problem with him now is, he has to clear the issue of the $16 billion. He has to clear the issue of the $25 million. He has to make sure that people put the assets into public knowledge. That's the only way Liberian people will know, oh, so you had $500,000 last year, but now you say you got $5 million. How you got it? Sometimes it doesn't work. Sometimes it just people may lie, but you have to start somewhere. You have to say, okay, this is a process. This is a constitutional issue for where to gain the trust, even of the international community. It's part of it. They know the code of conduct is a law. And the fact that he doesn't do it, people say, yes, they may break his law, his own laws. So how can you trust him? It's not me. That's the reality of politics. People follow you. When you travel with a government, what I know is that if you take 10 people on a government on a trip, the foreign ministry would sit down and Google every single person on that trip, and they know who they are, what they do, what their role is, what they come into that country. That's, technology has changed the face of governance. So I would say, go back to the code of conduct and resolve the issue of the $25 million, MOPAP. Resolve this $3 billion missing from that money. And then, hit the reset button. Mm-hmm. Every government that comes in, you sometimes give some people time to say, oh, thank you for helping me. You give somebody a job to thank them for helping you. But you have to know when to remove that person. You have to know when that person has served totally and can't go any further. And that's, I don't see it as a problem. I see it as a, growing curve, a learning curve, as you say, that, I hope you learn and then move forward.
There's a question on Facebook from Lai M. Dukle.
Yeah.
What was Ellen's contribution in the Liberian Civil War? I don't know if you know that.
She said she raised $10,000with ACDL. There are two branches of CACDL. She and Harry Graves supported the war. It was open. Amos Sawyer, Baronta, and other people said, no, let's wait and see. But they were able to raise money. She said $10,000, but there have been conflicting reports about the amount. And to tell the truth, I had never, ever asked her, about her contribution to the war. But there are things that people would tell you when they want to. If they don't want to tell you, you don't need to ask because they're not, you know. So I never asked her what she did with the war and what she didn't do and all of that. All I was interested in was back in 2005, she was the best of candidates. And I had known her, I had worked with her, you know, for a few years on my newspaper, my magazine published every month. So I said yes, and then I followed her. But it was
that was a very crucial question. I don't know why you wouldn't ask it.
What? No, but how can I answer something I don't know?
Because why you couldn't ask her? Because this is a war that destroyed 250,000 more people, and someone who accordingly financed it recruited Taylor. First, as we learned, she recruited Thomas Kuyongba. Kuyongba was killed in the process, and then came back with Charles Taylor. And you wouldn't really press her as your friend and someone you work with if she really did support the war at that level? You didn't care, or what?
No. It's not, why I didn't ask her is probably a personal approach to things. I believe that people will always let you know what they want to let you know. I was instrumental in getting her to appear before the 3-hour seat. She didn't want to. Everybody knows that. I have email to prove that. I said, no, madam, you have to be the first one to speak. But to go ask her, madam, what did you do during the war? What you didn't do was not really things that, it's not my habit. I'm not personal with her. We're very professional, although I have known her since 2001. I probably wrote more articles about her with her and wrote more speeches with her than anyone else. You know, from the time Ellen became president till she left, I went to her house about 4 times, 12 years. I only meet her in the office and not more than 10, 15 minutes. When I have a meeting to resolve an issue, I go with my team and we sit around the table, we talk about it. That's how I worked with her. During the campaign, I used to go every day. I was there before everyone at the house. After the campaign event, I was the last person to leave the house. But when she became president, I never went to her house. 3 times, 4 times in 12 years.
Moses Nyimpa is also asking about the involvement of Dr. Sawyer.
Mm-hmm.
In the Liberian Civil War, when it comes to connection with Taylor financing, you said the ACDL was on 2 levels. Yeah. Did Dr. Sawyer also support the war?
No, Dr. Sawyer didn't support the war. I think that was, he was the one who said, let's see where the men's going. Let's see first where Taylor is going with this. But at the time, I think Ellen was more adamant to say, we need to help him if we want to get anywhere. So she and Harry Grave raised that money. According to some report, there were more money, but I know definitely Amos was, when you look at the name ACDL, it's Association of Constitutional Democrats in Liberia. It was not a violent movement. It was not.
The same with Model. LPC was Liberian Peace Movement.
Mm.
So I get that.
Yeah, well, Liberian Peace Council came with guns. So.
Yeah.
Yeah, they came with guns. They didn't, there was no if and bad about it. They came to kill.
Right. But what I meant is that the name wouldn't really mean anything.
Yeah, the name, in the U.S., they were raising money in the U.S. I don't think the U.S. was in a position in those days to do anything, to do some that kind of thing. No, I don't think ACDL raised that kind of money. It was made more private money from people from different angles.
Dempster Yala say, could Dr. Dukule elaborate further on what he means by I couldn't be VP and allow anyone to defeat me in an election, regardless of what the election result says?
If I knew that I'm VP, I'm running for president. If I really want to be president, I will work hard. I will make sure that my standard bearer, my president, is on my side. You know, I told Buckeye people, I told Chairman, what's his name? Pay, we had a meeting. I said, you know what? Every time you attack the president, you lose a percentage of votes. And no matter how bad a president is, he or she always commend 10, 15, 20% of the votes until they leave office. And that could be your margin with, you know, at the election. He said, oh, you, Doc, you don't know. I said, pay. The 20% that follow Ellen will not vote for Boakai. And that's the, will be the margin of the election. If I say I won't lose, it means that I will not sit back. I will have done anything to get Ellen on my side. I will have done anything to get everybody on my side. And I will have done, I can tell, you know, Boakai campaign did well, but everybody who was part of the campaign in 2011 and 2005 was put aside. Everybody who worked on those campaigns. So if you, I would not have done that. It was like a tent that was built for coronation rather than a tent that was ready to go campaign. And I would have campaigned so much. I would have campaigned for 10 years because I would have followed the president. I would have gone anywhere. He had a chance to go around the country 10 different times to make, to let people know him without the president being there.
Right. He said it was a car park in the garage.
Yeah, well, you know.
So what role did you play in parking that car? You were the advisor.
I went to Boakai many times. I talked to Joe because of my friendship. My brother Samuka and I went to him many times. A lot of times he would tell me things and I go to the president. I don't know. There are things that it's hard to say in public when you say it for the first time. That I would say, oh, yeah, at some point, Ellen was not happy about him, but I remember talking to her about it. I said, madam, now that he's a candidate, you have no choice but support him. So I don't know. What I'm saying, I will not leave because I don't think I will lose. Because if I'm vice president for 12 years, I will not be parked in a garage. Sure. Definitely not. And I will not allow anybody to park me. I'll leave and go do something else.
I know.
But if I decide to stay and then run for president, I'll make sure, because you as vice president, you know the country, you know people. Everywhere you go, people see you as the next president. And he didn't build on that.
Let's go back to the Liberian Civil War before we conclude, because we really don't want war again.
There'll be no war.
Right, but what are we doing to avoid the recurrence? Because this is one of the programs that is even telling people about the Liberian Civil War. We don't have that education. People are still talking about the American Civil War, about slavery, but we don't talk about it.
Yeah, but we don't talk about it because we have this thing that, you know, somebody once told me Liberian people like to move on and they always leave Liberia behind. We like to move on things, you know, say let's bygone be bygone. And that, you know, I've always said that when you have a problem, resolve it. If you don't resolve it, we like to pile up problems and then get up in the next morning and pretend that nothing happened yesterday. And unfortunately, that's what happened with the Liberian War. People don't think it happened. There's a new generation of people who don't even think about it. And we who survived it, who went through it, we know what happened. Do we want to talk about it? Some people don't want to talk about it because of the war, because of how they survived. But definitely, you know, how we can avoid it is make sure that the things that took us to the war, bad governance, exclusion, corruption, those things are eradicated. And that every Liberian has a chance to live to their full potential. When you do that, you know, you don't have, Mandingos will not blame you, the crowd people will not blame you, the gay people will not blame you, the Bazaar people will not blame you. Everybody say, I got this because I know book, because I went to school. But if you start putting people in things that my cousin or that my partisan, either he good or not, I want to put him there and then he break things and then you get up in the morning and say, okay, I trust you again, then you got problems. You know, definitely, yeah, if we don't want war, and I don't think there'll be another war, but you know, there could be violence. Yeah. There could be violence. Security people did well on June 7th. It would have taken anything to just blow up that whole city, a small spark. But the fact that young people went and danced and ate and drank and then went home means that, hey, we're getting somewhere. You know, we are also-
Yeah. The question of reconciliation,
mm-hmm.
I don't think we have made some serious effort in reconciling the people, especially you work with President Sirleaf. She said that was one of her things that she feel like.
Because the reconciliation is a myth, political myth.
Okay.
People always talk about reconciliation. And I say, when was the last time the Basa people took guns to go kill Maniwa people? I mean, since 2003. So this idea of reconciliation, I think the best reconciliation is to give everybody a chance at a table. Let people know they have the capacity to do things. Let them know they have the right to do things and that their rights are protected and they can do anything. And then you won't have a war. You know, the reconciliation is, you know, America talks about reconciliation. Every Democrat, you know, there are 23 Democrats running now. You ask them, they all think, I want to bring our people together. I want to bring our people together. I want to create reconciliation. There's no such thing as national reconciliation. You have a nation, you have differences, and people live through the differences. When you become militarized, then you have a problem. But ethnicity is part of a human life. People, you know, you go to Italian community, they will say, oh, we're different from the WAFs. You go to WAFs, they say they're different from the Puerto Rican, whatever you want to. But they don't have guns to shoot them. And that's why we need to stop. I don't think there's anything wrong with feeling different and say, oh yeah, we're better than you, I'm better than you. Everybody says that. But the problem is, do not bring it into the political process. Don't bring it
up. Dr. Duke, reconciliation is not about that though. Let's say during the war, crowns and crown on one side, then we have the Ma and the Da on the other side fighting. You have Gu and Man on one side, or the Ma and the Da, and then you have the Mandingo people. Some of these people were being targeted. So after the war, we have to come and sit together and kind of talk about our differences and maybe say sorry to each other and resolve that we're not going to do it again.
I think this is where probably President Weah can make a difference. Because I remember when one of my last interviews with Ellen before she went to run for the campaign was, what were your priorities? And she said, one of my priorities would be a national conference. And this is one thing I reminded her often and often and often. I said, that national conference has never happened. Now, Mr. Weah has promised to have a national dialogue. And I think that dialogue can serve as a basis for that national conference, where people will sit and talk about their differences and see how they can meet halfway and see how they can live together again and move as a community. I believe that. I think, you know, that can be done through a national conference that Ellen has not done. This is something that George Weah wants to do. And I think it's a very good initiative. And I think people should embrace it. And it shouldn't be for Photoshop, you know, photo shoot, you know, photo, what do you call it?
Photo
up, but a real conference, prepare for a long time, take 5-6 months to see it, set up a secretariat, 5-6 months to know who's where, and before you start it, so that, you know, the effects of that conference will lead Liberia into a new path.
I'm kind of a little, it's interesting that you say, you know, reconciliation is myth, we should live through our differences. I don't know your ethnic group, I can assume you are Mandingo, but it is one of the ethnic group that is most of the time complaining of being marginalized, of being cheated, you know. So let's talk about Mandingo.
Well, the Mandingos, our parents, I think this is the first generation of Mandingos being in politics. Our parents mostly would say, yeah, cola man, we're selling cola, you go to the mosque, and or you go sell your diamond or your gold or whatever it is. But this first generation, starting with Alhaji Kromah's generation, I keep coming back to him because he was probably there. And then Edward Kesley, in the Talbot government. Mandingos have stayed on the margin of politics, like many Liberians. The other tribes were also excluded. But after the coup, education and all of that, our parents, our generation was going away. We got involved in politics. We got involved. And of course, as latecomers, we were also always on the margin. But we also know our numbers. So maybe we have not strategized to see how we function in a democracy, in a democratic process, but we know we have power of numbers, we have power of wealth, we have power of knowledge, and how we use all of that in the framework of the national, national, what do you call it, framework is different. No, I don't say Maningos are victims, except during the Nimba issue, during the war with Nimba, and the Nimbaians, some of the Nimbaians took over that revenge on the Maningos. So that was a big problem. But I don't think Maningo people never considered themselves, victims. They came from the Sahara, That's 3,000 miles away from Mali, from Liberia. It took them centuries and centuries to get there. So I don't think Maningos take themselves as being, what do you call it, victims or, And then talking about, Maningos mixed with everybody. I think people are mixed. If you go to Nimba, the mix is there. You go to Monrovia, Maningo people are mixed with everybody. But tribal ethnic identity comes up as sometimes crucial issues comes up, and then you fall back into your ethnic background and then try to resolve it. But I don't see Maningos as victim. I don't see them as being pushed aside. It did happen at one point, including during the interim government.
Because right now, a lot of Maningos now are at the helm of power, like President Selim, you were there, my colleague Amara and all these people. But we continue to hear sometimes, as you say, those things come and we fall back. Like the latest issue was with Kabina Jane. Some tried to say that he's being targeted because he's Mandingo, but there were some Mandingo people that said, no, that's not the case. There's a political issue.
Well, about that case, I actually formed a small group of people, Mandingo elders, leaders and elders, Mandingo Muslim leaders and elders. And we wrote to the president, a big group of us. Some of them, a lot of people couldn't sign it because they had, they're part of the government. But we never raised the issue of ethnicity. We never thought cabinet was dismissed because of ethnicity. We always thought it was a constitutional snafu. It was an illegal thing to do on the part of the government, and that was it. But we never at one point raised the issue of, I knew his father, the father knew my dad. We pray in the mosque, we pray in the same mosque for years and years. But definitely we never ever told the president. It was the president who ethnicized the issue by appointing another Maningo man to replace him, which was kind of naive, I think.
Well, Dr. Duke, we've talked a lot, we covered a lot of ground. Our main topic for tonight was your war experience, what has transpired, and how can we avoid the war happening again. Let's close with your final thoughts.
Well, my final thought is I don't think it's a fragile state as people say. I think we have weaknesses. And I also think that the country has turned the curve, is on the right path. The economic difficulties will pass. The U.S. went into recession 2008, 2007, you remember. Those things will pass, but they will not go away alone. You can't just pray and sit down. People have to work, and President Weah has a lot of work to do. He appointed a cabinet from the election that was a thank you cabinet. All his partisans got good jobs and all of that. That was very good. And now, in the aftermath of May, June 7, he has to take a new look at his own governance and decide what he wants to do going forward. But personally, I think I would take him seriously the day he make his asset public, and the day he asks every minister, every employee, every person in the executive, if you don't declare your assets by next week, stay home. Just like he has said it. He said it. He gave them a deadline. Nobody complied, and he moved on. Mr. President, you can't do that. You president. And he got stopped taking gifts from friends and say, my friend gave me an airplane to boost my morale. What bigger morale is there than to be president of a country? So that's my parting thought. I think we're on the path to recovery. We're on the path to development. We just got to get used to the noise of democracy. Okay, you go ahead.
Well, Dr. Duke, I mean, yeah. It's been a wonderful time talking with you.
Yeah, okay, one of my...
okay, somebody, okay. Yeah, you can bring up, that's our Father's Day. Hey, yeah, guy, what's your name?
That's Barry. Okay, so thank you very much, and it was my pleasure to talk to you, and I hope we'll continue the discussions. And I think Liberia is on the path to recovery, but, you know, there have been some mistakes. Sometimes you just say, we made mistakes. Let's reset and start anew. We got time. You don't build a country in 15 years. It takes more than that.
Okay. Thank you
Joshua,
so much.
Let him cool off, take time, and do the right thing, and everything will be okay. Poverty never take you to war.
I wonder when he called you, you're going to be willing to join his government to work.
I never joined LN government. I worked for LN, but I never joined the government. Yeah. I don't join government. Even Dr. Sawyer, I was outside of the government. So I'm an independent media person. I do, even when I was working with LN, I was also doing my private business. I had a business, consulting business going on. Yeah. Even now, that's what I've been doing for the last 20 years, 30 years since I left the embassy. I never worked with anybody. But definitely, if my advice is needed, yeah. I'll be the first one to jump on the plane to go help.
Good. I'd like to hear that.
Yeah.
And we'll be glad to have you back.
Yeah.
And because we still want to pick your brain on a whole lot of issues.
Okay.
But thank you so much for joining us. I want to thank all those that are watching us. Thank my guest relations manager and also my co-host not here. Till next time, this is Dennis Jha wishing you all happy Father's Day.
All right. Without any bias and everything.